eligible.
It's such a friendly word. You're eligible to win this. You're eligible to be poked in the eye with a sharp stick. Would you go for that offer? Well, how about when you're told that you're eligible to take statins because of your cholesterol level? In this video, I'll discuss why that's an offer I'm steering clear of. Stay tuned. So your doctor is likely following a standard of care when deciding to recommend statins to you. As a matter of fact, if they don't follow the standard of care, I guess they can get into a little bit of liability difficulty, so they're going to be following it. Various entities, organizations, have different standards of care based on 10-year cardiovascular risk. Now, I went around and went to the various different sites to find out what these health organizations are recommending, and here's some of the ones that I found. If your 10-year cardiovascular risk is greater than 7.5%, so in other words, you have a 1 in 13 chance. You can look at it this way. You have a 12 in 13 chance of something not happening, a 1 in 13 chance of something happening. The next one that I found was greater than a 2.5% chance if you're aged 40. So in other words, a 1 in 40 chance of having a cardiovascular event over the next 10 years if you're age 40. Another one was greater than 5% if you're over the age 50, 1 in 20 chance. And again, we can look at those as, well, there's a 39 out of 40 chance that nothing's going to happen, or a 19 out of 20 chance. Or one of the most interesting ones, and this is what a lot of doctors seem to go by, is if your total cholesterol is greater than 200 milligrams per deciliter, and in millimoles per liter, that's 5.1 millimoles per liter. So if you're from that part of the world where that's the measure, that's what they're using. I went to a standard calculator, and in this case, I used the American College of Cardiologists, American Heart Association, Atherosclerotic Cardiovascular Disease Risk Calculator. My risk was calculated at 11.9% based on my gender, my age, my lipid profile and blood pressure, and my family history and lifestyle. I'll do a separate video just on risk calculators, but for now I just wanted to tell you this is one that I went to that I got this 11.9% value from. I also found, just by playing with the numbers, that I can reduce it to 5.1% if I lower my total cholesterol to 130, which is about 3.3 millimoles per liter, and raise my HDL-C to 100, or 2.6 millimoles per liter. And I can reduce it to 5.1%. But that standard of care that I talked about, greater than 5%, was likely to net you a recommendation to take a statin. That was the best I could do playing with this calculator. So no matter what you put in, if you're age 64, I mean, they'll let you fill in the rest. They won't stop you and tell you, oh, by the way, we're going to recommend you on a statin. But every single individual in the world, presumably, at age 64, or at least all the men, I didn't change the gender on that, should be on a moderate intensity statin. Sounds a little suspicious to me that there's nobody healthy enough to not be on a statin, but that's the state of things right now. So the question comes up, is cardiovascular disease risk all that counts when it comes to cholesterol? Well, let's look at a typical medical journal article intro. And here's one that we'll look at the results of. Hypercholesterolemia, which means high blood cholesterol, is a well-established risk factor for coronary heart disease. But the association between cholesterol level change and mortality is not fully understood. So they have to pay homage. If you're going to get something in a peer-reviewed journal, you have to pay homage to this idea that high cholesterol means cardiovascular disease risk. Right? They have to do that, or they'll never get anything published. And then they can go on and actually present their data that may actually kind of show that. They won't point it out overtly, but they'll let the data speak for itself. So here's the problem. Cardiovascular risk is not all there is that's related to cholesterol. Your cardiovascular system, and sometimes I think your cardiologist, it doesn't own your cholesterol. Cholesterol is a vital substance for your health. It's not just part of your cardiovascular system. It's part of your neurological system. Your brain is actually the biggest user of cholesterol in your body. So that paper looked at mortality figures for different total cholesterol levels and different causes of mortality. They looked at all-cause mortality, they looked at cardiovascular mortality, and they looked at cancer mortality. Well, let's look at the cardiovascular one first, because that's kind of interest to the people watching this. And it shows that around a cholesterol level of 200, not below 200, but 200 is statistically the group of people who had the baseline mortality, in other words, the minimum mortality. If you strayed higher or lower than that, then you actually increased your chances of having a fatal cardiovascular event. Now, going to the low side, it really wasn't a lot. That line there slopes up just slightly, and I believe the gray area is margin of error. And as you go to higher levels, well, yeah, it goes up a bit. And if your level were at, it looks like 550 or so, then yeah, you'd have about double the risk of somebody with 200. But let's look at all-cause mortality, because that's the one that's more interesting. And that's the one that counts to me. I mean, okay, if I avoid a heart attack, but I die of something else, what have I really gained? And in that case, the best mortality seems to be a little bit over 200 total cholesterol. Now, this is a group statistic, 30,000 Americans. Group statistics don't apply to individuals necessarily, but let's just see what the data is saying. And you'll see that as cholesterol decreases, mortality increases very sharply, even compared to when cholesterol increases. Mortality increases a little bit. I mean, because like I said, around 210, 220, whatever it is the minimal. But it seems like lower cholesterol is worse for your health than higher cholesterol. And we can look at the data for cancer survival, and very similar. So this is kind of different than what we're being told. I mean, if your level is at 220, if you're a typical person, well, if you're part of the group, your mortality is at its lowest. So why is your doctor trying to get it under 200? So let's look at the study conclusion. And I've shortened it to even with this. In summary, a U-curve association of total cholesterol level with cardiovascular disease, cancer, and all-cause mortality risks was observed in the American population, suggesting that cholesterol levels that are too low, I added the emphasis there, or too high in the serum might, I don't like the way they worded this, increase the likelihood of adverse outcomes. Actually, that is assuming there's a causal, that the cholesterol causes the mortality rather than the general health causing the cholesterol level, which also correlates to the mortality level. They went on to word a little better in a moment. A low total cholesterol level was linked to, and I think that's what they should have used, was linked to, up above they should have used it, was linked to adverse outcomes, linked to additional adverse outcomes. Total cholesterol levels less than 200 milligrams per deciliter, or less than about 5 millimoles per liter, might not be indicative of good health. And I think that's the word indicative there is probably also a better way of putting it. So I have friends who have bragged to me that their cholesterol levels are down into 130s. They don't have a cholesterol problem. Well, actually, they do have a cholesterol problem because their cholesterol is probably too low. Though, of course, again, group statistics don't necessarily apply to individuals. But if you're bragging about your untreated with a statin, cholesterol level being down around 130, you've got nothing to brag about. And if you got down there because of a statin, that's a whole different question that I will address in a future video. Let's look at a different study. This is actually from a study of about 13 million Koreans who were just followed for mortality, and their cholesterol levels were compared to their mortality. Now, this chart here, the 65 to 74, is about a million Koreans. Now, granted, Korean society is different than ours. I'm sure their dietary, regimen is different than, say, parts of the Western world. So how much does this apply? But it looks exactly the same as what the 30,000 American study showed. Now, when I was actually had already written all this up. I was watching a Sten Ekberg YouTube video. And if you're not watching Sten Ekberg YouTube videos, you should be. And he actually brought this same study out. And I'm like, oh, I've been scooped by Sten Ekberg. But in fact, that's kind of hubris on my part. He's got over 2 million viewers. And as I'm making this, I haven't even launched the channel yet. I have no subscribers. So anyways, you see, this is the same kind of curve. Now, it doesn't look as sharp as it goes to the lower values, but I noticed that they use a logarithmic scale for the mortality risk here. You know, it's all relative. If they'd use a linear scale like the other charts did, I mean, there's legitimate reasons to do it either way, but this would be steeper and it would look very close to the all-cause mortality chart that I showed you from the other study. So you notice, once again, and I'm most interested in the 65 to 74 age group, and the 220 level is the level that statistically is the one with the lowest mortality. And if we look at like a level of 300, that's one that, you know, if 200 gets doctors all upset, 300 is going to give your doctor the heart attack. But by this data, and this is what Sten Ekberg pointed out, that's no more dangerous than 160. Or another way to look at it is having a level of 160 is as dangerous as 300. And by the way, anecdotal evidence here. So not really evidence, but an anecdote. One of those people bragging to me about their low cholesterol did die very young. He had other comorbidities. He was morbidly obese. I thought he was okay because of his cholesterol, unfortunately. And he was a great guy, and I miss him dearly. So let's look at this 130 value that I had to put in to get the minimal cardiovascular risk out of that risk calculator. And I can't even find a high, I mean, it's off the chart. That risk level doesn't even correspond to anything reasonable for higher cholesterol. So this idea that the lower the cholesterol, the better, is just, it's just ridiculous. And if your doctor is using that to treat you, well, we'll have something to say about that. So here's some medicine for thought. Here's what the statistics show us. All-cause mortality is minimized for people statistically, doesn't necessarily apply to individuals, with a level of about 220 or 5.7 in the other units. And that's the optimal total cholesterol level to minimize all-cause mortality. Up to 140 or 3.6 millimoles per liter for the optimal LDL. That's the so-called bad cholesterol. I'll have a lot to say about that in a future video for optimizing all-cause mortality there. So shouldn't your doctor, this is rhetorical, shouldn't your doctor be encouraging to raise your level to 220 if it's lower than that? Well, again, you know, that's a group statistic thing and maybe you shouldn't, but if your doctor, they definitely shouldn't be treating you using the wrong statistics and instead should individualize your treatment and stop compartmentalizing your health needs. And by that, I mean, don't minimize my cardiovascular disease risk by increasing my all-cause mortality or increasing my cancer risk or increasing some other risk. Treat me as a whole system. My health is a system. It's not, you just can't take one thing and set it aside. And that's what cardiologists do because they're concerned about your heart. They're not concerned about your brain except insofar as a stroke could affect your brain. But you know, your brain is actually the major user of cholesterol in your body. So if you start messing with your cholesterol, you're not just doing things to your cardiovascular system, you're messing with your head. So then this is the rhetorical question. Is it possible for your doctor to individualize your treatment with 2 15-minute visits a year in the exam room? Well, think about that. I think you know the answer. So as usual, please like, comment, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell, and if you haven't seen it, I recommend that you take a look at this video. Thanks for listening.